Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents I'm Still Here, A New Philosophy of Alzheimer's Care by John Zeisel, narrated by Stephen Bell Davies. Author's Note: If you would like to share your story with me and others, please email it to mystory@imstillhere.org. You are invited to share experiences through which you have been touched by compassion. Responses to following the mindfulness meditation I describe at the end of the book, and insights you have reached as a partner, what I call the gifts of Alzheimer's. My blog is available at imstillhere.org, as are reproductions of paintings and other visual material referred to in this book. Chapter 1. Embracing Alzheimer's, A New Philosophy of Care. Why is it that some ideas or behaviors or products start epidemics and others don't? And what can we do to deliberately start and control positive epidemics of our own? Malcolm Gladwell. I first became interested in the challenges of helping people living with Alzheimer's when about 15 years ago a nursing home operator approached me for program and design advice. My background is in environmental design, and he came to me because so many of the Alzheimer's beds in his special care unit were empty. At that time, I didn't realize this would become my life's work. It did, because the rather dry question introduced me to a field waiting for redefinition. My grandfather, whom we called Apus, lived with us on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. We called him senile and took it for granted that he was a member of the family with certain abilities, and there were some things we didn't ask of him. I never thought of his condition as an illness. That was the old way. Today, in North America alone, there are 5 million people living with Alzheimer's, each with an average of 5 care partners, making 25 million care partners. Worldwide, these figures leap to 50 million people living with Alzheimer's and 250 million care partners. The care of such people has become a major medical industry, with the number of nursing homes rapidly expanding, and with Alzheimer's drugs sold in the billions annually. Existing drugs and those in the pipeline that provide hope to future generations at best delay the disease a few months or years. They do not eliminate it. The prognosis for the future, many more people living even longer in the early stages of Alzheimer's than today. I have learned over the last 15 years that treating people with Alzheimer's the old way was often better, because they live at home, in assisted living residences, or in nursing homes. In order to treat people living with Alzheimer's as people rather than as patients, we first have to appreciate their capabilities as well as their losses. We need to see the person through the fog of the illness, and we have to employ as many non-pharmacological treatments as pharmaceutical ones. I have stayed in this field because I gradually realized how much the lessons I have learned about people living with Alzheimer's apply to others with physical, sensory, and cognitive disabilities. The treatment principles involved are equally valid for autism, mental illness, mental retardation, manic depression, diabetes, HIV, or even for a simple cold or a twisted knee. In fact, the fundamental treatment principles that I describe in this book are universal. The people living with Alzheimer's have also inspired me to stay in the field. The way the illness affects the brain leaves most of them exceptionally perceptive, increasingly creative, and highly emotionally intelligent for years. I have developed and tested these theories over the last decade and a half, running Alzheimer's assisted living treatment residences in Massachusetts and New York. We call them treatment centers because the physical environment, the communication, and the programs all independently act to reduce residents' symptoms, including agitation, anxiety, aggression, and apathy. I'm still here is the result of the lessons learned from this group of people and the commitment I have made to spread this optimistic message. This book strongly acknowledges that no one welcomes living with Alzheimer's, and that to date, there is no cure. Nevertheless, I'm Still Here looks at the positive side of this illness, the half-full rather than the half-empty glass. I advocate treating people living with Alzheimer's as people first, and then as those with an illness. I advocate including people living with Alzheimer's in society, at museums and theaters, among other places. I explain that people usually live with Alzheimer's for over a decade, and that for much of that time they can function with less help than most people think, can enjoy themselves, and can even learn new things. As important, the people who care for them can maintain positive relationships and share vibrant memories for the entire course of the illness through photos, music, art, personal stories, and visits to museums and other community cultural events. I'm Still Here is an invitation to a different worldview based on the realities of the big picture. The fact that there is no cure in the near future, the fact that millions of people living with Alzheimer's can live active lives rather than being institutionalized and hidden from society. The fact that how partners see the illness, positively or negatively, has a major impact on the partner with the illness. This book carries two frequently overlooked uncommon common sense messages. Number one, the skills and capacities of people living with Alzheimer's that don't diminish over time or do so more slowly provide windows for connection and communication. Number two, through those windows lie opportunities to establish and build new and vibrant relationships that can sustain us and them over time, supporting both care and well-being. Embracing and translating these two messages requires that we understand the following. Love is a universal language understood far into the illness, even to the end of life. If everyone involved with the illness learns to say, "I love you," to the other person will understand and be more present, and relationships can grow. Everyone has pre-existing instinctual abilities that building a caring relationship can capitalize on, such as our ability to understand music, facial expressions, and human touch, the meaning of a song, a smile, and a hug. Drawing on these innate abilities enables everyone living with Alzheimer's to function better than expected, because they are never lost. Memories are not held in just one part of the brain, into which we place them like a DVD disc for later retrieval. Rather, we place attributes of experience in various parts of the brain, faces in one part, colors in another, emotions related to the experience in another. Later, a brain function that acts like a call to Scotty in Star Trek, "Beam me up, Scotty," retrieves them. Art, music, environment, and Alzheimer's competent communication help those memories reappear, just as Scotty helps Captain Kirk and his crew reassemble aboard the Enterprise. Alzheimer's is treatable, and the best treatment is one that carefully balances non-pharmacological with pharmacological approaches. Non-pharmacological treatment includes carefully planning and managing both the social and physical environment of the person. It is important that all caregivers burdened with guilt remind themselves that Alzheimer's is an organic illness of the brain, and that sharing care partnering tasks with others is keeping a promise, not breaking it. Partners get sick more often than do the people they care for. Those who care for people living with Alzheimer's tend not to take care of themselves. They tend to get sick more often and for longer periods than the people they care for. Taking care of oneself is the surest way to help the person you love. People living with Alzheimer's live in the present moment. Mindfulness of being in the present moment ourselves is a first step toward being in the mind of a person living with Alzheimer's. Being totally present to our own breath through meditation can help us experience that fleeting moment, the Alzheimer's experience. This is as close as we can possibly get to being where we are and to being in the same place as the person we love who is living with Alzheimer's. Many people, as they grow older, forget one thing or another. This is not Alzheimer's. I'm Still Here provides a human understanding of the profound changes the person with Alzheimer's is going through. This understanding alone is the greatest defense against the fear we all live with, a fear that the research and other fundraising communities unfortunately promote in their desire for funding. Understanding also leads to compassion, a necessary ingredient for treating oneself well and for being able to give of oneself to the other person throughout the illness. A life with Alzheimer's can be seen as a glass mostly full or completely empty, and each is a state of mind. This book lays out a positive view of living with Alzheimer's that can lead to a life with quality for all involved, as well as to effective treatment. The Alzheimer's glass is more than half full in this book. A person living with Alzheimer's is first a person, and only then someone with the disease. The way the world sees Alzheimer's today is that a person is almost totally lost once he or she receives an Alzheimer's diagnosis, lost both to themselves and to those who love them. An Alzheimer's diagnosis is seen as an Alzheimer's sentence. But this just isn't so. Throughout the more than decade-long progress of the disease, the person is crying out, "I'm still here." We all need to start hearing that cry before it fades away completely. This book describes how much remains alive and vital in the brain of a person living with Alzheimer's disease and shows how certain parts of the brain even enable someone living with the disease to function more sensitively than before. If we rely primarily on drugs to alleviate the symptoms of Alzheimer's, or what most people assume to be those symptoms, there is little available treatment at present. Some cognitive enhancement drugs have some effects. Many have side effects. Some mood drugs can reduce disturbing behaviors, often at the price of reduced quality of life. In order to assess the impacts of medications and of non-pharmacological treatments on Alzheimer's symptoms, we need first to agree on what are symptoms and what are not. For example, we know that one symptom of Alzheimer's is difficulty dealing with complex situations, and that when a person faces these difficulties, she often gets frustrated, agitated, and sometimes aggressive. The symptom is loss of executive function in the brain's frontal lobes, and the concomitant difficulty dealing with complex events. The other effects are actually secondary or tertiary symptoms, if they can even be called symptoms at all. In the next chapter, I articulate these differences and explain how important it is to see them in order to be able to develop treatments that work and for partners to develop meaningful relationships with the people living with Alzheimer's. Non-pharmacological environmental and behavioral treatments can have dramatic results with few side effects. Symptoms that everyone thought were integral to the disease can be reduced. There is a new message to be heard. People living with Alzheimer's are still people. Alzheimer's is treatable. Don't give up. At this point, readers might understandably ask, "What do you mean, don't give up?" So much of what we hear and read and see about Alzheimer's paints those living with the illness as unable to cope with their environment, unable to relate to others, and having lost their sense of self. But to build healthy relationships with those living with Alzheimer's, each of us has to connect through those capacities and facilities that don't diminish with the progression of the disease, or at least diminish most gradually. When we listen to music or visit a museum together, we are building such relationships. We are also reducing the secondary and tertiary symptoms of Alzheimer's. Those living with Alzheimer's who use parts of their brains that still function well feel enabled and competent and are less apathetic, agitated, anxious, and aggressive. Alzheimer's is presented in a totally negative light, not only in modern advertisements and films, but also in classic literature. Although Shakespeare didn't know at the time that he was writing about Alzheimer's, he held the same view. At the end of Jacques's well-known Seven Ages of Man speech in Act II of As You Like It, Shakespeare refers obliquely to living with Alzheimer's disease in old age as a return to the state of childishness and mere oblivion. All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. At first, the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms, last scene of all that ends this strange eventful history, is second childishness and mere oblivion, sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything. While this is beautifully poetic, it is not accurate. It is easy to count the ways that the analogy between Alzheimer's and childhood is inaccurate. A child has limited history and memories, while people in old age, with or without Alzheimer's, have a long history of experience. They have lived through several historical eras in various cities and perhaps countries, and they have experienced the world changing around them in major ways. They have seen technology develop and political upheaval. Most have children and grandchildren. They know how to repair broken objects, cook, build houses, teach, write, paint, play piano, knit, to name a few of the things that they can do that children can't. They have profound personal life experiences. Some have fought in wars, marched for peace, suffered in concentration camps, or moved from the countries of their birth as refugees. They have held responsible jobs and achieved accolades for their achievements. They definitely are not like children. Another inaccurate perception is that when people are diagnosed with Alzheimer's, they have no future, that an Alzheimer's diagnosis is an Alzheimer's sentence. The condition lasts 10 to 15 years, a time span that definitely constitutes a future. What kind of future is it if people can't remember their children and where they are? Those who don't understand the disease ask. That question assumes that memories are gone, which they are not. They are just increasingly inaccessible without some help. It also assumes that the future is based in the past and in past memories. It is not. The future is based on many present moments, moments the person experiences fully every day and every minute. The future for people living with Alzheimer's promotes new relationships, quality of life, and joy. To see the future in this way requires us to realize that the person living with Alzheimer's is a new person with reference to the old person he always was, but that he is not that person any longer. Neither can our relationships be the same. While the person still cares for us and continues to love us and we them, we must have new expectations and build a new relationship. The first step is to discard old expectations and role relationships that limit our ability to see the person and relate to him or her in a new way. The person herself, as well as every family member, holds a key to keeping the whole family's story going into the future. Each family member holds one key to the person's past, present, and future. Each person knows and can share with others the major themes and scenes in her life that are likely to be embedded in memory. When family members are present, she knows who each person is, and she remembers herself, even if she may not be able every time to remember a name or a specific relationship. Family members know how to read the moods and body language of the person they love. They know how to provide joy and quality of life better than anyone, and they are the key to identifying the ongoing narrative. And in return, the person living with Alzheimer's knows her family members' moods and body language. This is a mutual process of understanding that does not end with a diagnosis. Every family member and close partner of someone living with Alzheimer's has experienced the person asking, "Who are you?" or repeating a question he asked and that was answered a few minutes before. "He's lost his memory," people say to themselves. Yes, he has a problem remembering certain things that his brain prevents him from embedding into long-term memory. Chapter 3 describes the brain regions that one must understand to reach the person behind Alzheimer's, those regions that are affected most, and those that hold promise for building strong relationships because they are less affected. Recalling a name or a recently posed question is really a small part of his or any of our memories. What about emotional memories of happy and sad times that can't be expressed in words? What about the lasting smile when his granddaughter hugs him and tells him how much she loves him? Among the memories lodged in his brain are the following types, each of which provides the opportunity for communication and understanding. Memories still there. Sense memories. Smell or fragrance memory, touch memory, visual memory, body memory, music memory, taste memory, sound memory, proprioceptive body memory, emotional memories, times of joy, sad memories, fear memory, pain memory, love memories, excitement, regret, shock, compassion, body memories, having a baby, riding a bicycle, throwing a baseball, putting a golf ball, dancing the foxtrot, breaking a leg, carrying a heavy load. Skill memories, cooking, dancing, drawing, knitting, bowling, sewing, digging. Hardwired memories, the sun, smiles, fireplace. Art memory, paintings, poetry, music, sculpture, dance. Environmental memory, color, place, object, texture, environmental mood memory, spatial memory. Autobiographical memories, life period memories, childhood, school, teenage years. Type of events, hunting, going to the beach, chopping firewood. Special event memories, family memories, my wedding, my son's college graduation. Song memories, popular tunes, religious hymns, children's songs, military music, dance music. Story memories, how I met my wife or husband. When I was a child, that time of life. Childhood events, when I saw my first movie. Fairy tales. Collective memories, major events experienced. World War II, D-Day, the Great New York City Blackout, Elvis Presley on the Ed Sullivan Show, the assassination of President Kennedy, 9/11. Social norms memory. How to be polite to others at dinner, how to greet someone coming to visit, how to behave at holiday parties, how to behave at religious ceremonies, how to behave at a wedding, just how to say hello. Tip of the tongue memory. Names you know, but you can't recall without a cue. Habit memory. Learning. Eating with chopsticks. Putting eyeglasses in the same spot every night. Setting a table the same way every time. The following memory types are more compromised. Cognitive map or wayfinding memory. I know where I am when I'm there. I know where I'm going if I can see my destination, and I know where I was going when I get there. Getting to the bathroom at night without a light. Finding your way back to a childhood haunt. Getting home from wherever you are. Factual, learned memory. Things I know. For example, the names of presidents, grandchildren's birthdays. Test memory. Cram for an exam memory. Complex sequence memory. Brushing one's teeth. Organizing a meal. Cooking a complex meal. Getting dressed. Putting a diaper on a baby. Packing for a trip. Message memory. Remembering what was just said. Remembering a person you met recently only once. Remembering a phone message just left with you. A phone call you just finished. A phone number. All these memories, except those at the end of the list, are readily accessible to people living with Alzheimer's and their partners. And message memory, factual learning, wayfinding, and complex sequence memory can be accessed with appropriate approaches and communication. As people age with Alzheimer's, they retain certain memories better than others. Some may be skills that are so ingrained, they express themselves without the person's thinking, such as knitting, hammering together two pieces of wood, putting a golf ball, or playing a musical instrument. Others may be hardwired in our brains, such as caring for another person in a time of need, seeing meaning in a work of art, or tapping rhythmically to music. Whatever the remaining skills, everyone has them, and everyone can be engaged if these skills are appealed to kindly and sensitively. Visiting a friend's ex-mother-in-law recently, we remarked at the beautifully knitted sweater she was wearing. She told us she had knitted it, and that she always knitted sweaters for her sons when they were growing up. My friend, who knits quite well, readily announced that she liked knitting, but needed help to improve. From then on, visits included a short knitting lesson. My friend brought the knitting needles, the skein of wool, and her desire to know more. Her ex-mother-in-law drew on her knitting skills and her deeply rooted sense of caring for another person to teach new stitches. The remaining memories of these encounters served to cement the new relationship the two old friends developed. Everyone has his own unique capabilities. These may include reading the newspaper out loud to others, singing, gardening, or dancing. Whatever they are there, and it is our job to uncover, celebrate, and embrace them so that everyone living with Alzheimer's, no matter where in the progress of the illness they are, maintains their dignity, independence, and self-respect. People living with Alzheimer's also retain critical powers of observation, even though they may have difficulty being reflective about what they see. When faced with an objective situation, the person at all stages of Alzheimer's can describe with great clarity what she sees. She is not burdened, as many others are, with reflective self-critical thoughts such as, should I say that? Or is that the right thing to say in this situation? The ability to observe and appreciate makes people living with Alzheimer's wonderful listeners and wonderful companions. They see so much that we take for granted, and thus overlook, whether walking in the park or through a shopping mall. They have interesting and often funny things to say. The person you love who is living with this illness is a wonderful companion. People living with Alzheimer's are artists, performers, and an attentive audience. An artist expresses himself from his heart, avoids being overly self-critical, and can unself-consciously express his self in his art. The lack of a fully functioning brain comparer makes many people living with Alzheimer's better artists than they were before the disease. Just as inventive artistic personalities who have little regard for rules of society are not deterred from their creative goals even in the face of obvious difficulties, people living with Alzheimer's are often freer, more honest, and more expressive than most others. The Artists for Alzheimer's program, ARTS, described in Chapter 4, is a multifaceted program that enabled people living with Alzheimer's and their partners to take advantage of such special creative abilities. One fascinating dimension of the artistic abilities that people living with Alzheimer's reveals, derived in large part from their canny ability to be present to where they are, to just be there, is that those abilities express themselves in both art appreciation and art creation. The insights people living with Alzheimer's bring to the paintings they see at museums are as interesting, amusing, and artistic as are the drawings and paintings they create as part of ARTS. When they are faced with an artistic experience, these perceptive skills emerge eloquently. Observing Toulouse-Lautrec's La Galoue at the Moulin Rouge, The Glutton, on a special tour for people with Alzheimer's that my colleague Sean Caulfield and I developed at the Museum of Modern Art, several participants instinctively commented on the roughness of the man on the left pulling the woman out of the bar, although the person on the left is wearing a dress and has long hair or a wig. Close observation reveals the person's thick hands and masculine features. Oscar Wilde, the famous playwright, was visiting Lautrec at the time he painted La Galoue, and this character, ostensibly La Galoue's sister, might well be an homage to Wilde. Art history books chronicle viewers' outrage at Lautrec, including such a rough-looking person in this painting. Participants' discussion about the roughness and gender of the figure, paralleling art critics' comments, is one of many insightful observations people living with Alzheimer's make in such situations. As an audience for the work of other artists, paintings, poetry, theater, music, circus acts, short films, people living with Alzheimer's are equally present and non-judgmental. They are all artists. As Merrily Sintra, an Australian artist and culture consultant, said to me after we discussed this subject, "Now I understand why I am so relaxed around people living with Alzheimer's. They are as artistic as I am." In chapters 4 and 5, I describe how visual and dramatic arts, museum exhibitions, music, theater, film, and the circus arts, touch people living with Alzheimer's in ways no other experience does. Art experiences enable them to focus for longer periods, to perceive and express their perceptions, and to access both long and short-term memories. Art of all sorts also enables people living with Alzheimer's and those without it to focus together on something outside themselves rather than on each other. Such shared experiences bring everyone closer together and serve as a basis for building new and strong relationships, the topic of chapters 7 and 8. While art experiences draw out people's skills and abilities and bring partners together, so do the physical environments in which they live. Design for people living with Alzheimer's, the topic of chapter 6, supports their independence. It helps them know the limits of where they are safe and know where they are going. know what is their own place and what to do when they are together with others. Design for people living with Alzheimer's reduces the secondary symptoms of the illness, those that are not directly caused by changes to the brain, including apathy, anxiety, agitation, and aggression, that to a large degree are not caused by the disease. Rather, they are caused by a person living in a place that is frustrating and difficult to negotiate. In Chapter 6, I discuss the design principles that support the well-being of those living with Alzheimer's. Camouflaging and otherwise reducing the importance of exits leading to dangerous places. Providing destinations at the end of pathways so people walk rather than wander. Providing people with a place of their own with their own possessions that reinforce their sense of themselves. Common spaces decorated and sized to communicate what the appropriate behaviors are for those areas. Gardens designed therapeutically and with safety in mind so that residents know what time it is and what season it is. Making the place like a home so that people living there with Alzheimer's feel at home. Making certain that all the sensory inputs, colors, sounds, textures, are those that residents understand easily. Supportive environments that enable everyone there to do what they can by themselves. Art, environmental design, and music reflect the message of personhood that is clearly there to be heard. People living with Alzheimer's let you know what they think, clearly and often. They might not use the same words to express themselves as highly left-brain people might, but they can be just as eloquent. Later in the Alzheimer's journey, the expressions may be in their smiles or furrowed brows, in their body language, in the way they embrace you, or in the glint of recognition in their eyes when they see certain people again. It is too easy to classify those who have lived with Alzheimer's for many years as non-people, because they might no longer relate to the world the same way they used to, or as we think we do. Discarding people in this way reduces their quality of life and ours. We burden them with disregard and loneliness. We burden ourselves with having to visit again and again, with nothing to say and do, just wait until it's time to leave and resume our lives. The dozen or more years living with Alzheimer's are marked by different levels of cognitive ability and impairment. During that time, and especially in the early stages, everyone living with this disease is capable of meaningful relationships, perceptions, feelings, and involvement in life. Why does society shunt these people away, rather than find ways to involve them in our lives and our communities? One reason for this is our own ignorance of how to build a relationship with someone going through the changes associated with Alzheimer's. Everyone who loves and takes care of a person living with Alzheimer's faces what appear to be insurmountable odds in developing a new relationship with that person as she or he changes. Despite these fears, every relationship between a person and someone that person loves who has Alzheimer's can still be vibrant and rewarding, even improved from earlier relationships, but only if both people first get to know each other again. The new relationship each person establishes can be mutual, with both partner and person living with Alzheimer's expressing their needs and having the other respond. Everyone who learns to say, "I love you," to the other can have such a relationship, because love is a universal language understood far into the illness, even to the end of life. People who want a relationship also have to learn to say, "Please help me," when they reach the end of their rope. Only those who take care of themselves can be there for another person. For someone who does not have the disease, It may seem selfish to think about oneself, but it is necessary. When traveling and at parties, because of my unique position managing assisted living treatment residences for people living with Alzheimer's, I often find myself in conversation with people facing Alzheimer's and a family member or friend. I don't tell them they ought to build a relationship with those they know and love. Rather, I draw on their own inner knowledge to develop with them a picture of how they might engage the person behind the illness, provide meaning, and establish a positive relationship between them and the person they care about. I tailor my stories to their unique situation as a friend, a family member, a spouse, a child, or a professional, whatever their partner relation is. I tailor the stories to the responses the person has to our conversation. "My mother doesn't recognize me. What can I do?" they might ask. I ask how they address it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.